So this lesson, How Are Human Rights Protected in the UK? This is the second, this is lesson two, if you like. The ones that we've just done were 1.1, 1.2 and 1.3. They were all part of the same thing. This is lesson 2.1. So this is, we've looked at the philosophical underpinning of rights in that previous lesson. That's what we were doing, that thing. We looked at kind of, we had a look at the laws in a big picture way. You know, the Universal Declaration, the European Convention and the Human Rights Act, you know, we introduced those to ourselves. What this lesson is about, it's more of a practical look at the various different laws as they are and the institutions which put them in place. So the European Court of Human Rights. A lot of this is about the European Union, which links in with a little bit, I suppose, with the project thing. So what we're going to be looking at over these next few lessons is, again, not to write down, but we're going to be looking at the role of the judiciary. That's what we're going to be looking at this hour. The role of the judiciary within the UK and the role of the European Court of Justice and the European Court of Human Rights. These are all taken from the syllabus, so, you know, nothing is just frivolous. It's all what we should be covering. Then we will look at some NGOs, some think tank stuff tomorrow, and we'll look at those two aspects of things over those lessons. So we're looking at some case studies, and the case studies that I want us to have a look at in more detail tomorrow. I want us to look at that whole euthanasia debate in more detail and how that linked in with the whole Human Rights Act and what was actually done about it. It's quite a good case study to look at, and the various people who took individual cases and why they did it and what happened. And that, because all that links in with pressure groups, etc. Very controversial. Okay, so today is more of a practical thing, the role of the judiciary. So, again, some of this is... Right, so the judiciary and human rights, that's what we're looking at. By judiciary, what do I mean? The justice system. And there's three parts that we're going to look at today. We're going to look at British courts. I don't know if you might just want to draw that, or just that little diagram thing, or you can just make notes as you wish, but... Three things I want to look at is the British Courts and Human Rights, the European Court of Justice, and the European Court of Human Rights. So there's these three things which keep human rights in the UK, like practically enforced them at a practical day-to-day level, so to speak, with rulings. Okay, so again, some of this, particularly that bit, is atrocious. I'm sorry, but it's me again thinking, getting my head around things. Right, so what I want to start off looking at first is the. So British Courts and Human Rights, if you want to put that as a subheading. And then I'll zoom in on these different things. And again, just try and summarise. So that's one summary, British Courts and Human Rights. Right. So, first off, the thing that we need to know is that England, and we do need to sort of talk about England here because Scottish law is slightly different, etc., Northern Ireland is slightly different. Right, England has this, maybe we can reach back a little bit, remind ourselves from the judiciary stuff that we did. It's taken England a little while to come to terms with the idea of human rights because we have a tradition of common law. Can anyone remember what common law means? I mean, I know I've got some stuff on there. I suppose that's the most important bit. Do we remember any of this around English law and how it develops?
Is this the Magna Carta?
So. British law or English law is based, it's what you might call a freedom law, which is, the basic idea is everything is legal apart from that which is banned. Yeah, no, I don't. So the way that the way that, forget about rights for a second, but like in France, everything is illegal apart from that which is permitted. Do you get the difference there? So in it, the tradition in England is you're free to do anything you want apart from the things that are illegal.
Kind of like drugs, in a way.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yes. Still all right to do it.
Yeah.
Because you haven't
it. Yeah, and indeed drugs were legal in the UK. You could get heroin and stuff until the Victorian era. So yeah, it was it's free to do anything until it becomes illegal.
What did you say about France?
Whereas in France, it's everything is illegal apart from that which is permitted.
So they have like laws that are allowed and stuff. Like
yeah, things that you're allowed to do. Whereas, yeah, if you want to think of it that way, so in England it's laws that you're not allowed to do, whereas in France it's laws that you're allowed to do. Yeah, so I mean, take that with a pinch of salt, but I've heard that said many times about that. That well, it's called Roman law. Have you ever heard of that term, Roman law? So that's kind of how Roman law works. That the you know going back to the emperor, there'd be all these things that you weren't allowed to do, and the things that weren't on this list you could do. Whereas in English law, there's all the things you can do, and then there's a list of things you can't do. So it's meant to be freer, if you like, because there's an infinite number of things that you can do, and a few things that are banned. And over time, that's obviously got longer. So drugs is a good example, because up until the Victorian era, it was perfectly legal to buy and consume drugs in England. I don't know what
year. So it's like one GMS, not a one GMS.
Yeah, yeah. Right, and how does that link in with rights then? So rights are a list of things that you must or must not do. I mean, it's both. You must do this or you must not do. Whereas, so that's set up in advance. That list is there, and you have to go by it. Whereas English law is based on this idea of precedent. Do you remember this? Whereby it's very organic and it evolves, and there's no real set of rights, so to speak. It's just based on individual cases and how does it track across time. Were you going to say something, Connor?
It's like if you judge one case one way, it sets a precedent that you judge them all the same way.
Yes. Whereas the rights idea is that before you've done any judging, you have this list of things that's already set out, which some people would argue is inflexible. Where they would argue that the common law way of doing things through precedent is better because it's more flexible and it evolves naturally, so they would say. So this is an argument that this is why England or even the legal system has taken time to catch up. Because we have, let's say something. Because there's this tradition of freedom-based common law. Yeah. So we've signed these documents, and now we do have a predetermined set of rights. You know, in law. Today. I mean, personally, I do think it's better to have a set of rights that are there, because then the government can't just make stuff up as it goes along. And we'll look at a couple of examples of where it did and where it's been struck down. Having a look at some of this later on, you know, Britain has not been challenged as much as I thought it would be in the European Court of Human Rights. The worst offender is Turkey. Turkey, even though it's not in the European Union, is still a signatory of the European Convention. And that gets something like 71% of all the cases brought against it from Turkey. Turkish people, should I say, the public.
Not surprising.
Yeah. Britain is only like 5%. So we're doing pretty well in terms of sticking to this. So any further thoughts about that idea? Do we understand that concept of how this is slightly different? It's a step change for English law. Right, this next one is atrocious and it's got tons of stuff on it because it was me thinking out loud. But let's see if we can unpack this a little bit. Right, so how does this relate to British courts then, the Human Rights Act and all this stuff? Okay. Are we all right to move on? Right, so right, so how does this work in British courts then? Can you even see that on the board? Yeah? Right, so this is where we need to pick this apart a bit. So all courts in the UK must follow the Human Rights Act as closely as possible in their judgments. So they've got to follow it as closely as possible. In theory, technically, they can make judgments contrary to the Human Rights Act. But what will happen is, immediately, if you were that convicted person or that legal team, they were, and the court judgment was contrary to human rights, you would immediately take that to the Court of Appeal, because you would say that court's judgment is not in line with the Court of Appeal. And then that would lead to a whole massive review and the law being changed. I'll read through it and then I'll unpack it right. So all courts in the UK must follow the Human Rights Act as closely as possible in their judgments. However, if a court passes a judgment which seems to go against human rights, then the judgment will still stand, but the convicted party will take it to the Court of Appeal. If the Court of Appeal makes a declaration of incompatibility, then Parliament may change the law. Technically, even as a signatory of the ECHR, Parliament does not have to pass laws that accord with human rights, but it usually does this and implements declarations of incompatibility to prevent continuous future appeals which can result in compensation being paid out, as well as the humiliation of UK citizens having to appeal to European Union courts to challenge British laws, as is their right under the European Convention on Human Rights. Right, so can we unpack that a little bit? How can I unpack that?
It's like a set of strict guidelines.
Yes.
We don't have to follow all the time, but if we do break it, we've got to justify why we've broken it.
Yeah, and in effect, they get changed, and they get changed more often than not.
So it's tangible.
I'm so confused.
Yeah, okay, so... Yeah,
basically, like a fluid concept that changed over time, but we've still got to follow the basic structure. That's how I understood it.
Right. So, that's true. Let me see if I can unpack it even further. Right. So, we are a signatory of the European Convention on Human Rights. So, and the Human Rights Act. So that means British courts have to try and follow the Human Rights Act when they're giving a verdict, but they can actually give a verdict which is contrary against human rights. Why? Well, for whatever reason, and we'll look at some examples. Actually, one reason, an example that I'll pull up was: do you remember last week when I talked about the European Convention on Human Rights, and it was this derogation in time of war, whereby
yeah.
you couldn't be under martial law.
Anyway, yeah.
Yeah. Well, have you ever heard of, if you get arrested for a terrorism under the Terrorism Act, you can be kept without trial for 90 days. Right. So that is one area where the government has sent people to prison for 90 days. The police have held people for 90 days, and that goes against the Human Rights Act. But the government kind of resisted and said, no, we're not, we need to keep them for 90 days. Yeah, because they're at risk of society.
So
now,
it's like the prisoners' votes in Havana.
Yeah, we'll come back to that. Let's just take some time unpacking that. So, right, so let's say that you've one of those people that's been held for 90 days. You get out and you say, right, my legal team, you want to sue the hell out of the government because they brought the Human Rights Act. So you either take this to the Court of Appeal, and the Court of Appeal would make a declaration of incompatible. So it would say that whatever law the government has made is incompatible with human rights. And then, even though technically they could say, no, we're going to ignore it, the pressure is so great on them that they usually will, and more they do. They usually will change the law. Because they'll keep getting sued by people all the time until they change it. Yeah. Plus, it's humiliating for the British courts, for people to keep going, let's say they end up going to the Court of Appeal or to the European Court of Human Rights, and the European Court of Human Rights is continually saying, the British government's wrong, they need to change this law, they need to change that law. So the pressure is on the government to change the law and make it in line. That's where the pressure comes from. Because you might ask, well, if they're not technically bound to do it, why would they bother doing it? It's because every time that someone gets convicted under that law, which isn't in line with human rights, they'll go to the Court of Appeal and sue the government. So they might... It's just going to carry on and carry on until they change the law. So they might as well change the law. And that's what happens, and that's what happens more and more and more and more in the British case. So that's where the pressure comes, and that's where laws are more and more evolving towards becoming in line with the Human Rights Act. What other examples of that were there, where the government had changed the law? I'm trying to think of a more positive example. I'll just have to come back to that. There are a couple that I was reading about where you might think, oh, that's a good thing.
Is an Irish for everyone, not?
It may have been, but I'm not sure about that. I think one that was, that you might think was positive, was journalists not being required to give their sources. You know, if you get a secret source from someone, and the law as it stood before and said people could demand to know where you got that source from, and that there were some journalists that took that to the European Court of Human Rights and took it to the Court of Appeal, and then the law was changed, so that's no longer you don't have to reveal your sources. That would have been after the Iraq War. That would have been after the death of Dr. David Kelly. I don't know if you've ever heard of him. Complicated case. I don't know if you've got time to go through it. But right, okay. So, I'll get a few examples of. But what about this idea? How can I boil it down? Let me think. Right. So. British courts technically don't have to follow human rights, but if they pass a judgment which is against human rights, they will get the government. They will go to the Court of Appeal, and the government will get sued so much that they'll just change the law through, because it's easier than having the hassle every time. Right, let me try and write that down. Okay, so it's ease of writing. So British courts. UK courts do not technically have to make judgments in line with HR. But if they do, those governments, those judgments will be challenged in the Court of Appeal in the Court of Appeal, and you could add the European Court of Human Rights if it gets that far. So, challenge to the Court of Appeal, and the government is highly pressurised to change the law because they don't want to be continually sued because it's too much hassle. Yeah. And it is highly likely that the Gov will change the law to prevent continuous further litigation.
I think there's watching this on TV once about this guy who was trying to see the
government for not letting prisoners vote. Yeah. And then like a massive debate on whether it should or shouldn't, but he was basically saying it was just human rights.
Yeah.
And like,
that's been a big thing that's been going on, isn't it? Like, prisoners fighting for the
votes. Mm. We did, we watched it in this class. John Hurst, the guy. basically remembered. Yeah, no, that's good. Yeah. But it was, but he did, and he won his case. But again, this is kind of, that was a big, big one that the government was trying to resist, but eventually they would have had to because they kept getting cases took against them. Mm. And he was
so
the first one.
Nice.
Well, it didn't go through, but again, it'd be interesting to see once we leave the European Convention on Human Rights and the European Court of Justice and the European Court of Human Rights, whether they'll still be able to get that ruling done through the Supreme Court, or whether they'll just scrap it.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, so we're going ahead at the moment. To prevent continuous... Do we know litigation? That means basically suing. If someone litigates against you, they're suing you.
Mm-hmm.
To prevent continuous litigation... prevent continuous litigation and hassle. By wronged individuals. I know the first thing that I came up with was better than that, but that's the thing. Right. Does that sound all right? Does that make sense? The UK courts do not technically have to make judgments in line with human rights, but if they do, those judgments will be challenged in the Court of Appeal. And it is highly likely the government will change the law to prevent continuous litigation and hassle by wronged individuals. Because just keep getting sued all the time by the same people going through the bad law. Does that make sense? Or yeah? Yeah, so basically that's that big thing. That's good. That's quite a good little definition there. Yeah, so as you were saying, Connor, it's kind of fluid, but in the end, and increasingly all the time, they're getting tighter and tighter until they have to follow these human rights things. Okay, so that's one level, the court, the British courts. Smeary, but that's right. Right, so then there are two other bits to this human rights stuff. Okay, in our little trinity. So the next one is the European Court of Justice down here. Come back to those videos in a sec. Right, so the European Court of Justice. Okay, maybe if that's possible to write that down. Right, so there's two aspects of European, the judicial system. The first one is that building there, which is the European Court of Justice. Right, so this one is something that you need to know about, but it's in the syllabus. But this is a court, but it mostly, and it's about the European law, but it's mostly about trade disputes between different countries within Europe. So if Germany and France fall out about tariffs, let's say they feel like one's been ripped off, they've not given them a fair deal in some kind of business way, they will go to the European Court of Justice and they'll arbitrate between them. So I suppose if you think of it, a thought that's just occurred to me, if you think of it, you know, like a family court, but for the different European countries. And it's not so much about the human rights stuff, it's about when countries fall out over borders or something like that. So I suppose you might think of it, it's like countries used to go to war over this kind of stuff. Now they go and get it sorted out through the European Court of Justice. Yeah? So this one is not so much about human rights, although it does link to that. That's the European Court of Human Rights. So let's say two countries have got a dispute over some law. I mean, are we aware with what these terms mean? So arbitrates. So arbitrates is just when
it's
two...
Like mediation.
Mediation, yeah. So that's what the European Court of Justice does. It makes sure that the laws apply the same in all EU countries, but it's mostly to do with business and trade deals. Making sure that contracts are enforced properly. Which... You know, it's a big part of what the European Union is, and it will have a knock on when we come out of that, because we won't be able to. We'll have to probably pay. Let's say Britain comes out of the European Union, it does individual trade deals with individual European countries. If there's a dispute, it will then have to pay, you know, it's like solicitor's fees, I suppose, pay to get all its stuff sorted out through that. And it can fine countries for not doing that, but. Watch a couple of little videos, but that's more of a, you need to know about that exists, but this is more about legal disputes rather than human rights. So instead of having wars, we go to the court and get it sorted out. That's how we do things in Europe these days, which is more civilised. Okay. is a bit of a boring technical one. It was there. Okay, so let's just watch a couple of little videos about what it's about.
There's one for every member state. These are the judges of the Court of Justice of the European Union, followed by 11 advocates general. The environment, economic and monetary affairs, competition, employment and social affairs, research and innovation, health, and many other areas are regulated by EU law. It's the same in all member states. The judges clarify the interpretation of union law when requests are made to them by national courts or by colleagues. They also deal with certain cases concerning annulment and appeals. Other judges assist them through the General Court in cases concerning annulment brought by individuals, companies, and in some cases by member states. The cases they handle concern most often trade, competition law, trademarks, agriculture, or state aid. They also deal with disputes between the EU and its staff. With a continuously increasing caseload, there's a backlog to be cleared. 600 cases a year before 2010 grew to 912 in 2014. At the end of 2015, an unprecedented 1,270 cases were pending. New judges will progressively reinforce the General Court. In September 2019, each member state should have two judges and maintain equal gender parity. This way, the court should be able to reach its decisions in a timely manner, as required by the Charter of Fundamental Rights.
Okay, so, I mentioned that earlier, but what kind of disputes is it mostly dealing with, this European Court of Justice?
Civil
disputes about trade and trademarks and agriculture and all that kind of stuff that he mentioned. Another impact, which you could say about Brexit, it says, talking about having a judge from each country that arbitrates, that's on that panel, and then there'll be two by 2019. If we leave, we won't have any input into that. Our judges won't sit on that. So again, if we leave the European Union but we're still having to do business, the European Court of Justice, well, all those countries will come up with their own rulings, but we won't have any influence anymore over that ruling, because our judges won't sit on that court. We won't be part of it. So again, you could argue that's making it harder for Britain to do business.
I haven't actually thought this through properly.
Okay, so let's have a look at this next one.
As citizens of the European Union, we all have rights under EU law. These rights are ultimately interpreted and safeguarded by the Court of Justice of the European Union. In over 25,000 rulings to date, the Court has given decisions on a wide variety of matters directly affecting our lives. Example Case 1. Air passenger rights. Thanks to court judgments, if your flight is delayed by more than 3 hours, you can claim compensation. The court has also ensured that airlines cannot cite technical problems as an excuse to avoid paying. Example Case 2, Google and the right to be forgotten. The Court of Justice has ruled that EU citizens have a right to ask a search engine, such as Google, to remove entries relating to them from the list of search results following a search on their name, giving us greater control over our presence on the web. Example Case 3. Medical treatment within the EU. In a series of cases, the Court of Justice declared that if a citizen goes to another EU country in order to receive medical treatment, they should be reimbursed by their national health insurance scheme under the same conditions as at home. If this treatment requires a stay in hospital, the home country can insist that they give prior authorization before treatment takes place. But the court has ruled that this can't be refused for standard procedures, unless the same or equivalent treatment can be provided at home within a reasonable time. This principle is rooted in the freedom to provide services.